sense the presence of the Lord in this house. And we thank God for the anointed man of God. God has used down through the years to usher us into the very gateways of heaven, the very presence and throne room of God. He doesn't need a long introduction. His anointing speaks for itself. Won't you please help me welcome none other than Bishop Clifton Jones. Come on, praise God for the gifts that reside within him. Bishop Jones, we thank God for you.
Thank you very, very much. I think you can be seated. Allow me to say this. I'm delighted to be a part of something that is something. I'm delighted. And I say that because there are things that appear to be something that's nothing. Anybody that would take time to pray, they are into the oldest program and the most productive operation that has ever existed on planet Earth. So thank you. And I'm so thankful for the invitation. I was willing to move some things to make sure I got here. Amen. I was willing to move some things. Now, normally I'd be in Houston, Texas, but I'm in Indianapolis, Indiana, last time I checked. Hallelujah. I want to do something that I think makes a difference. Before I give you a subject or text, let me say this. We are guilty of doing things out of habit, observation, instinct, without really knowing the foundational facts supported by the scriptures. Now, I'm going to spend my time this morning on the purpose of prayer. Purpose. And I'm going to share at least 10 verses of scripture. At least. I might just get exorbitant and go to 11 or 12. But I want to do it. And my reason for taking time to give these type of instructions is to improve what you do and to establish a consistency to help you keep doing what you do.
Yes.
See, and trust me on this, no matter what position the person holds in Christendom, if he or she is not associated with prayer, don't even bother about whether or not they are up or down. Praise God. Prayer is what we must have and what God offers to keep us in touch. The thought hit me this morning. This is a new one. This is new to me. Very rarely you see a person without a cellular phone. Am I right? You got two. You got two. I'm going to say that again. And please remember this. I am old enough to repeat myself without feeling guilty. Okay. Very rarely do you see a person without a cellular phone. What are they for? Thank you. First lady had it right the first time. They are designed for communication. So in this lesson this morning, purpose of prayer, I promise you the word communication is right on target. Dictionary.com, some of you probably know him. He defines the word purpose as the reason for which something exists or is done, made, used, etc. So, the purpose of prayer, why is prayer so important? Where did this idea come from? What is the goal of this prayer business? Who is concerned about it? Who should be involved in it? Why does it mean so much to the originator? See, I hope I can answer some of those questions. See, in order to encourage the practice of prayer, I think it's good to know the purpose of prayer. Would you say that again, please, sir? Thank you very much. I will. To encourage the practice of prayer, I think it's good to know the purpose of prayer. That's twice. This is the third time. To encourage the practice of prayer, it is good, it is necessary, it is important to know the purpose. See, anybody ever ask, why do I have to wash my face? Now listen, the scriptures reveals the purpose of prayer. That's why I'm going to give you enough scriptures to build your confidence and faith in the practice of prayer. That's why I'm going to give you scriptures. Now, if someone offers you something and gives you the directions how to use it, you should at least pay attention.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
I went to pick up medication for my wife, and they got a new procedure at Walmart where the pharmacist explains how to take it, what to expect when you take it, and even what happens if you don't take it.
Yeah.
So I'm standing there listening, because I got to convey that to my wife. But you see, one year, we sell medication, and we also give instructions on how to take it to get the best results. God gave us a book called the Bible. And gives us instructions on this prayer business. I want you to look now in Deuteronomy chapter number 4, verses 29 through 31. See, this is a good book. That Bible is a good book.
Yes.
It gives you so much information.
Yes.
See, you run into someone and say, I know the whole Bible. Just keep walking. Because they got another lie to follow that one. See, the Bible is so relevant, so fresh. You read it today and get a portion of what is offered. Come back later and read the same thing and get more. And I'll be the first to admit, I have some understanding of prayer, but I don't know all about prayer. You got that? Yeah, I'm testifying now. Had an occasion, got called yesterday, a person that had called me and prayed for a certain matter. When they got finished telling me what had happened, I said, the only thing I have to say, I thank God for the prayer that I prayed. That's all I said. Yeah. And God turned that thing around. It was so amazing it was a legal thing. It's so amazing to the secretary of the attorney call with amazement, I've never seen this happen before. Oh, excuse me. I haven't learned how to control myself yet. I do go off. Verse 29, but if from this thou shalt seek the Lord thy God. You know, when I read a verse like that, It makes me understand that God knew in advance that somebody would look for him. I got this thing so set up, you can't operate without me. Uh-huh. And if you come to your senses, you're going to call me for help. Yeah. If you stay spiritually retarded, you're going to keep bumping your head. Yeah. Verse 30, I'm jumping down. When thou art in tribulation, thou shalt not get a rope and tie it around thy neck with one end in the tree and jump. That's the book of Jones. That's the book of Jones. In tribulation, call me. Hey, when you can't handle it, call me. When you don't understand it, call me. When you can't figure it out, call me. When it don't seem to be working, call me. When the answer you thought you had turns out to be against you, call me. When you try it and it does not work, rather than throwing in the towel and surrendering, call me. I'm getting ahead of you. I'm getting ahead of you. Yeah. I don't call the Lord. Did nothing happen. What do you mean didn't anything happen? You say you called? Yeah. How many times you called? I called him 20 times. Are you still alive? Yeah. Is God still alive? Yeah. Keep calling. Long as you are alive and God is alive, there's hope. Unless you bought into that lie years ago, God is dead theory. See, most of us knew better than that because we were still hearing from him. Oh, when thou art in tribulation and all these things are come upon thee, even in the latter days, that's the day we're in, if thou turn to the Lord thy God, I shall be obedient unto his voice. Now, if you don't intend to follow the instructions, ain't much need of you calling him. See, some of us, some people are so smart, they do harm to themselves. They're too smart. See, you're smarter than God, you're too smart. See, God don't have to work it out, figure it out, and try to understand it. See, he arrives on the scene with full ability to take care of the situation. See, there's nowhere in the Bible that said God went back to school to take understanding 101. Nah, verse 31. For the Lord thy God is a merciful God. Thank you for that, Lord. Thank you for that. Thank you for that. A merciful God. A merciful God. One that sees where you are, but has the ability to look beyond where you are, see where you ought to be, and give you the grace to get there. That kind of God. That kind of God. Yeah, you know, we sing this, used to sing this song. What a mighty God we serve. But if, you know, we used to sing that. Yeah. We talk about change that song. He will, oh my God, he will not forsake thee, neither destroy thee, nor forget the covenant of thy father, which he sware unto them. And that kind of stuff is inspirational and motivational. And Psalm 65 and 2. O thou that hearest prayer, unto thee shall all flesh come. That no flesh has the ability to face life's difficulties without having some question to rise in the mind and some darkness to overshadow him or her and need light. He turned to you, Lord. Unto thee shall all flesh come. Verse Psalm 86:3, be merciful unto me, O Lord, for I cry unto thee daily. Jeremiah 29:12, Then shall ye call upon me, and ye shall not go in and pray unto me, and I will hearken. You says, go and pray unto me, and I will hearken unto you. Just encourage you. Just don't call. I'm listening. Uh-huh. And I'll get to another point after a while to show you from your Bible that not only are we crying, God is also listening.
Yes.
Hmm?
Yes.
He said it. And he's not a lying God.
Right.
If he said he's listening, that's what he's doing.
Yes.
He said he's looking, that's what he's doing.
Yes.
And his hand is not short. No, his ear is not heavy.
Right.
Mm-hmm. He does not have retinitis pigmentosus, glaucoma, or any other debilitating eye defect. He can see. He knows where you are, how you got there, what it takes to get you out of where you are. The turn you need to do. He has all that information.
Yeah.
God's plan and purpose of prayer is applicable today as it was yesterday.
Yeah.
We're not talking about a used to be God, a used to be prayer program. Yeah, the church used to pray. And if the church does what it should, it's going to pray today. Because
yes.
The devil hasn't gotten saved yet in Mississippi. He hasn't repented yet. Hallelujah. He has repeated, but not repented.
Yeah.
What you say? I say he has repeated, but he has not repented.
Right.
Amen. God has purposed to safeguard his people.
My God. Thank you, Jesus.
This is extra. I should charge for this, but I'm not. One of the things you and I can learn from the devil is persistence.
Yes.
Anybody has attacked people as much as he's attacked the people of God to only see them delivered and not give up on messing with them, that's a sign he's persistent.
Yes.
You said no to him today, you think he won't come back? He'll come back the same day. No, lose his chain. Say, well, I'll come back.
You're talking good, Mister.
Get behind me, say, not real this time, but if every chance I get, I'll come and face you.
Talking good, Mister.
And then don't talk, tell anybody I told you this. Satan has never had a body, never. But to watch how he manipulates bodies, you would almost think he once had a body. There's something he had, H-A-D, had, that we have, that he wished we'd lose. When in Genesis 2 and 7, God breathed into man the breath of life, man became a living soul. A living soul behaves toward God different than a dead soul. Genesis chapter 3 show you what a dead soul does. When Adam's eyes came open, he saw that he was naked and heard God, what did he do? He ran. Naked soul, dead souls run from God. Living souls run to God. Which one are you? I ain't going out there today. They ain't having nothing but just prayer. That's just what I need. I'm alive. I need mouth-to-mouth resuscitation so I can breathe again. I tell people that are listening to me, you don't administer mouth-to-mouth resuscitation to a person
that's
safe.
Right, that's right.
They already say it.
Yeah.
They don't need mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. They need to shut up. It's the person that's having difficulty breathing.
Yeah.
If you're having difficulty seeing things, you have difficulty believing things, you have difficulty holding on to things, you have difficulty opening your mouth and giving God credit for the things in which he has done, you need mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. If you find yourself sitting in the building in body, but your mind is in California, you need mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. God. I think two of the major signs you look for after administering and mouth to mouth resuscitation, the person needs to either sneeze or cough. That's a sign that the contact is made.
Yeah.
See, we got a lot of folks in the church need to cough. I'm through being dry. I'm through being cold. I'm through playing hook and them Bible games. I'm through. Oh, I'm fine. I got lost for a minute there. God, I'm gonna say, I've already said, God has purpose to safeguard His people. God is looking at us, see where we are, see what is after us to make sure we have His presence to overcome whatever comes against us. God does that. Look at God. What a mighty God we serve.
Mm-hmm.
He's given us, what is God now? You are going to safeguard us. What are we to do? Pray. And now what does prayer do in reference to safeguarding us? When you are alive and alert, you have so much confidence in my presence that you're not afraid of that which comes against you. I learned something from my pastor that in this modern day, I don't think is popular, but he sure taught this. He said, you don't have to leave the building to backslide. Yeah, in fact, you don't have to even change seats. I sure don't want to look right and be wrong. In America, that's the country I live in. We have learned how to put people in these high-priced boxes. Wearing those good-looking clothes, put all those expensive flowers around them, and send them somewhere they made no preparations go. Lord, help me, help me. When you think in terms of prayer, your mind go back to a song that was as older than I am, and that's saying something. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, now trust me, what you saw in the news recently, two celebrities committing suicide, that tells you pressure will burst a pipe. Jesus. I don't know anything that'll help us more than whispering. Communion to God. See, if you know you need help, don't try to impress us. Say, Lord, help me.
That's right.
Lord, help me. When I walked in here this morning, the atmosphere said, help, this is a help me, Lord, service. this is extra too. I love that word, H-E-L-P. See, it suggests to me that someone is attempting to do something. But the something they're trying to do is more than what they can do alone. So they ask for help. Do I have one or two in here trying to do something that you need help? I'm trying to live so I won't bring a reproach upon your name. Help me. I'm trying to maintain an attitude that would not end up being stinking thinking. Lord, I need help. Lord, my tongue seemed to break loose so easy. In fact, I seem like I got diarrhea at the mouth. Lord, help me. I just about stopped tithing and going to tipping. Lord, I need help. No, you know when you use the word seeking God, the deep book, you don't really need to seek God. God's everywhere. But since you're so smart, let me tell you this. God can be right there at you and in you, but if you don't do and say the right thing, He'll act as if He's not even there. See, we're trying to get God to stir Himself up. See, it's not a matter of fact. Well, brother, when you got to see something, that's a sign you ain't got much faith. Brother, I'm going to tell you something. As long as I've had the Holy Ghost, every now and then I want him to move. Yes. I don't want him to go to bed on me. Yes. I want him to move. Yes. Do something. If you have to keep me, do something. Yes. God, I want to know you there, not catch you there. And say, God, he used to be there. I want you to move. If you want to stretch out, Lord. If you want to walk around in me. Whatever you do to make you happy, do it in me. Since I'm so close up here, I want to say this too. Check me out on this. You can go from Genesis to Revelation and notice everything God ever touched, it brought change.
Oh, yeah.
The earliest one I'm going to mention, and I'm going to skip Adam. See, Adam was mud. When he touched it, became a living soul. I'm going down to Exodus. And the waters rolled back. They were able to cross on dry land. Just because of the involvement of God. Go to Numbers. There's a donkey carrying a man. And all of a sudden, the donkey starts talking. Oh, when God touched something, brother, it does things that you wouldn't imagine. See, then I'm fast forward. Now, zoom, I go over to the book of Daniel. God touched lions, and they became a pillar. And the man of God could sleep in the lion's den. Over to Jonah, he touched a whale. The whale became an incubator. You know, a whale is going to be a mammal. And mammals have a digestive system that has a strong chemical in it. Anything that chemical covers is supposed to dissolve it. Now this guy spent 3 days because God, you read the scripture, he said, prepare the fish. When God touches something, he prepares it to do what needs to be done. I'm asking him to come down here on meadows and touch some folks and prepare them for the thing that he has in mind. Somebody walk out of here today differently than you walk in. God, I hope that something woke up inside of me that I cannot contain myself. I must glorify his name. I must fulfill the call. I must receive revelation. See, the manifestation of God is simply God making known that he's there.
Yes.
A guy claiming to be rich and can't buy a narrow pair of stockings, don't pay him any mind. Now I'm going to throw something in your mouth. God is said to be watching and listening. Psalm 34, verse 15. Take these home with you, mull over them over and over again, and see whether or not they will fill your personal need for spiritual advance. The eyes of the Lord upon the righteous. He's looking. He know where we are. He know how long we've been here. He even know why we came.
Yeah.
Woo! The eyes of the Lord upon the righteous. His ears are open unto their
cry.
That's me. I love that word here. Help! I'm trying to do something. I better throw this in. When you start screaming for help for yourself, and you are surrounded by sophisticated religious non-believers who think you ought to shut up. They are so intelligent these days, they won't just look at you and say, brother, sister, why don't you just shut up? They give you a shut up look. try and holler a little bit louder. Hey! Teaching Bible class one night, and I got on that health thing, and I said, listen, all of you in here that are carnal minded and have difficulty ascertaining whether or not God sees you, get you a banner or something and start waving. I'm over here, Lord, help! Let's move on.
Go ahead.
God is, I think, God's history ought to be inspirational enough for us to know, since he does not change, he'll do it again. And furthermore, since he is no respecter of a person, I'm getting ahead of myself, but sometimes I tell folk this: you cannot accuse God of having done something he shouldn't have done, and someone can blackmail him. He does things for us out of the purity of his heart, with full knowledge of what's going on. What a mighty God we serve. Oh, what needless pain we bear. Oh, what needless pressure we bear. Oh, he just a cry away. Hallelujah. Help! Lose yourself in calling on him. If you have to call by yourself, go ahead on. Listen, get selfish. Say, God, I'm not asking you to help us right now. I need you to help me. And don't listen. The three of you who feel you don't need any help, let me remind you that oftentimes God can use you and you try to take the credit unto yourself. You need help because you're messing in the wrong territory. You don't need God to use you and you try to pin the honor on yourself. Yeah, look what I just did. Please. Jesus was right the first time. Without me, you can do
nothing.
Come on, listen to that. Without me, you can do
nothing.
Now, that's not like I was nothing. Because sometimes we say something, and rather than repeat it, we say nothing. Anybody guilty of that? Ever seen that up? What you say? Nothing. Don't want to repeat it. But that, God's nothing is not like that nothing. He means nothing. He means no thing.
No thing.
Not a man. The eyes of the Lord upon the righteous. In other words, anywhere the righteous goes, he see him. Whatever condition come upon the righteous, he see it. The pitfalls that are before the righteous, he see it in time. And if they call him, he can steer them around it. And if he chooses to let you go into it, it's a sign he's going to teach you a kind of lesson that when you come up out of it, you'll be so thankful, you'll watch more cautious and careful next time.
Yeah.
And furthermore, he allows some things to come up on us to help finish developing the us in us so we can be more reliant on him. Lord, help me not to be so self-confident, but be fully God-confident.
Amen.
I'm going to tell you all now, if I say this today and the next time too, I'm guilty of saying this over and over again. God has tremendous confidence in himself.
Yes.
And anybody want to argue, all you got to do is go back, start at the garden. No, before we get to God, let's go to Isaiah 14. Lucifer was cast out.
Yes.
What did he cast? What was he thrown out to the what? To the earth. Now, where did God intend to raise his family? mad. You gonna put a guy down there like that? And he's already mad? Oh, come on, friends. Come on. He has confidence in himself. God is saying, I put him right where I'm gonna raise my family. There's nothing he can do I can't undo. Anything he breaks, I can fix it. If he tear down, I can build it up. Well, see, that kind of truth really strengthens your confidence in God. God, since you, Lord, please forgive me for saying this. Lord, and since you're so bad, just help me get closer to you. Since you can handle everything, help me not to get out of reach. Help me to abide under the shadows of the Almighty. Help me to lean and depend on you. Help me to learn how to call you at all times. Suggests his confidence in himself. He knew once he created Adam that God that he cast out would mess with him. He knew that. And he's angry. He hit the earth man. Truthfully speaking, don't y'all tell anybody I told you this. One of the reasons God became a man is to put that troublemaker in his place. Now, any Trinitarians, what I just said might have messed with your theology. What do you mean God became a man? I meant what I said. I didn't say God became something that looked like a man. Hallelujah. Yeah. Now this actually has nothing to do with the lesson. In Isaiah 7:14, he picked out his mama. He gave a description of her qualification. A virgin. Not one of them that's been passing out samples. Not a tribe to see if you like it. You see, I am H-O-L-Y, that is my nature. I cannot be contaminated with something that is polluted. So I need, the deep folks say, well, I'm just going to say, if he didn't have an earthly father, and how did he get his DNA, and where did his blood come from? Now, nobody asked that about Adam. He didn't have a mama nor daddy. Nobody asked about his blood. Now all of a sudden, Jesus' blood is under the scrutiny.
Wait, did he have a daddy?
No.
Well, how did you get a child no daddy?
Well, the God who became is the God who was and never ceased to be who he is. He was able to breathe in the right place, get the right result, and then... Now, I like what Paul said in 1 Timothy 3:16. And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh. God, not God was. I know what John 3:16 say. Most of you heard it over and over again. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son. All of us had trouble with that in the first place. If he loved that much, why he got to send somebody else to do the dirty work? He came himself. Isaiah 59:16, he looked and he saw there was no intercessor, his own arm. See, when I came from Philadelphia, Mississippi, I brought four arm with me.
Woo! Well, he didn't come, but he sent his arm.
I don't think you ought to still be sitting there if all was up here with the arm. If the arm wasn't a part of me. Oh, I'm sorry. I got off on that. Please remember now, we're still on the calling. Psalm 50 and verse 15. This home run with the bases loaded. Psalm 50. And call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver thee, and thou shalt glorify me. Hallelujah. I want to tell me and you, listen to me talk to myself. Once an individual is delivered, a sense of appreciation awakens within that person, and the mouth flies open and praise goes up and thanksgiving, because I have got what I needed. He didn't leave me where I was, didn't give me what I deserved. He looked beyond what I had done and showed me what I could be, and there's something inside of me said I owe him a praise. From the rising of the sun to the going out of the sea, he's worthy.
Hallelujah.
He brought me out. I didn't escape. See, I don't mean any harm, but you know, we spend a lot of time trying to get folks to give them a praise. Uh-huh. Come on, let's give them a praise. Now, I looked at what Psalm 142, verse 7 said. It sounds like to me we got the horse behind the cart.
Yeah.
He said in Psalm 142 and verse 7, bring my soul out of prison that I might praise thy name. Now, if you're out of prison, you ought to automatically praise him. But if you're still locked up, you need a jailbreak.
That's good. That's good, sir.
Lord, when I look at where I am, I didn't look at where I was. I didn't look at where I could have been. I have to give you thanks that you didn't leave me where I was. Called me, hadn't seen him in years, but he got into a situation that he didn't know the answer to. He called three other people. Then he said he thought about me and called me. He said, he not called you because I knew you would tell me the truth. I said, let me tell you something, son. Number one, there are no easy answers for hard problems. And furthermore, if you want a thing bad enough, it's going to cost you something. Yeah. And therefore, you got to be willing to go through it or pay the price for it.
Uh-huh.
See, now this is, I shouldn't even leave this in Indianapolis, but since I'm here, I'm going to leave it. One of the sad scenarios of the modern day church, we have developed a bargain price mentality. We done let Walmart's everyday low count discount price, the Family Dollar and Dollar Tree, a 99 cent and less. I know they got that in California. It has changed our mentality. We didn't get the salvation at a bargain price. He paid full price. Oh, by the way, let me advertise my next book. The next book is Top Price for Damaged Property. And I picked up some revelation on things that really blessed me. And if it blessed the reader like it blessed the writer, somebody will be blessed. Don't ask me when it's going to be ready, because I'm still combing over it. And I want it just right. I wanted to minister to soul. I want a person to read that and say, Lord, have mercy, help me. And some of what you heard just a few minutes ago, is in there. See, that bargain price mentality has made us live cheap.
Come on, sir.
Think cheap. Believe cheap. Worship cheap. Praise cheap. You know, yes. Half praise. You know, clap your hand like you got rheumatoid arthritis. Sing like you got lying giant. Why don't we reach back and get it?
Yes, sir!
But talking about hell. And I made the statement, I said, the church really need a help me Lord service. And I told him how I'd go. In a help me Lord service, you don't rehearse, you don't play music, you don't do anything. The moment you walk through the door, you come in and say, help. The bishop, I was at a council, the bishop caught that thing, he went home that Tuesday night and had a help me Lord service. He called me the next day and said, Bishop! Man, that thing worked. I don't remember now. I don't have the 100% memory. But he told me the numbers of people that got filled with the Holy Ghost. It was something, man. Woo! And all we had was a help me, Lord, sir. Help me, Lord. Help me. Help me overcome me. Help me to overcome them. Help me to overcome it. Help me to overcome my bad thinking. Help me to get my joy back. Help me to get my joy back. No one is in a position to know better than you as an individual if you are anywhere near where you once were, and if you're not, are you intending to stay where you are, or you want to get back to where you were? Yeah, I remember years ago, I used to run your eyes. Now all you run is your mouth.
Help us.
God ordained prayer as a means to protect his believing children from the hurt, harm intended by the enemy. I know he's going to try and mess with them, but if they will work with my system, I have developed a system of communication where they can stay in touch with me, and whatever he brings upon them will not seduce and batter them in the manner it would if they didn't call me. Call me, show you. I call that prayer as wearing your hard hat in a danger zone.
All right, now.
Something bound to fall, but you got your hard hat on. Lord, I give me the kind of protection that though I walk through the valleys of the shadows of death, I will fear no evil. Give me a thing. And let me tell you, right now, the devil is a master when it comes to intimidating us with D-E-A-T-H. Y'all ever heard of death?
Yeah.
You're going to die. You're going to die. Next time he tell you you're going to die, say, if I do, you can't mess with me anymore. Because where I'm going, you can't go. Go ahead and kill me with your bad self. Let me testify, my wife is my living witness. I have been seen to pass out any number of times. And the doctors who have checked me from this part down to my, nobody can find a reason for what happens. And it basically happens on a plane. To pass out, I mean lose 100% consciousness. The last two flights, had doctors on either side. And when I came to myself, one at my head, one at my feet. And they said, you ought to do this and all that. I passed out in the hospital 10 years ago. I had gone to get a knee replacement. On the day I was discharged, I just passed out in the bathroom. Jammed my head, injured my neck. They put me on a 24-hour observance and running tests, nobody can find what's wrong. I've been preaching and telling, that's God's way of letting me know, boy, you better keep it together. Because I can wipe you out in a moment. But your house in order. And that's what I tell them. I told the doctor that you should have seen that look on his face on the plane. See, don't play. Be for real. Because you don't know when you will draw your last breath. And may I say, I'm getting ready to preach now. You don't have to be sick in order to die. Psalms 104, verse 29. Thou taketh away their breath, they die. Uh-oh. You don't get that next breath, brother, they can call anything you want for me. Well, I think he had a cardiac arrest. What is a cardiac? Why did he have to rest? She had an acute aneurysm. Acute aneurysm. A good looking one. See, listen, not getting the next breath, all it takes to die. Since none of us know when we will draw our last one, why don't we try to make good with the one we have? Amen. So that when the other one comes, we won't be left behind. And nothing we say after you are gone will change the condition you leave here in.
That's right.
And don't be kicking death and making it sound as if he's the bad guy. Oh, death, this, oh, the death is not the bad guy. It's how we live.
That's right. That's right.
I remember when the church used to sing a song went like this. Holy people, heaven. Y'all heard it too. And all down in that thing, if you live right,
heaven belongs to you.
Oh, heaven belongs to you. That intimidator, he loved to threaten us with death. Because death opened the door for fear. And fear kills faith, hope, and confidence. The more afraid one is, the less one can believe. As a fearful person feels as if God packed his bags, left town, and forgot to leave his address. A person walking in faith has no doubt in the darkest of night. Standing somewhere in the shadow, you'll find Jesus. He's the only one. Heaven understand, standing somewhere in the shadow, you will find him, and you'll know him by the nail prints in his hand. That's why, what time you would be afraid, and it seemed like you are about to go too far, that's why help comes in handy. Help me! Not to be seduced by the influence of my enemy. Help me not to doubt or waver in my faith. Help me not to lose my focus. Help me not to fall on my faith. Help me. And listen, anytime some of these old smart folks tell you, you don't have to call like that loud. God's not hard to hear. So, baby, I wasn't hollering because I thought God couldn't hear. I was hollering to keep my doubts from drowning me out. My fears kept raising his ugly head. So I just closed my eyes and hollered a little loud. One of the last things the enemy wants you to recognize that he is a very present help. That same enemy that knows more about God than we do, because he's seen it, we haven't. He's been around him. We have not been around him in the manner which the devil has. I mean, we forget that sometimes. See, that backslider came from where you're trying to go. He has seen what you'd like to see. I could be wrong, but I think he thought if I messed up Adam, God would do him like he did me. Boy, that was a mistake there. See, he messed up Adam and God put his work clothes on. Said, you done messed him up. That's my man. I ain't about to give up on him.
All right.
He got too much of me in it.
Yes, sir.
I do what it takes to redeem.
Yes, sir. Woo!
tell you right now, don't pull your brain trying to figure out what man really is that causes God to behave toward him the way he does. Don't try to figure that out. Get to heaven because the answer will be given up there. None of us down here know. Your brain is too contaminated to know why God invests so much in us. And you got better sense than to stick your little chest out and think you're so important that God can't make it without you. You got better sense than that, I hope. If you don't, raise your hand so we can call the emergency squad to get you out of here because you are crazy. He can make it without me, but I can't make it without him. And in spite of the things I have done, he yet has not given up on me. Evidently, he put something in me that is so akin to him, he ain't about to lose it. Job 7 and 17 asks the question, what is man? Psalms 8 and 4 ask the question, what is man? Psalm 143, verse 2, what is man? Hebrews 2 and 6 ask the question, what is man? And see, smart goes, I know what he is. He ain't nothing. Oh, you ought to be ashamed of yourself, accuse God of paying that much for nothing.
Amen.
Sacrificing that much for nothing. Putting himself at risk for nothing. Now, you got better sense than to pay $20 and get a Cadillac. Because somebody say your Cadillac is $20, don't tell you, leave it alone. Amen. There's something wrong with it. $20? Cadillac? I'm letting this one go for $20. You better keep it.
That's right.
So, the investment God made on what was damaged proved to me that God saw worth beyond our ability to see. See, as hard as you look, you can't see it. It's there. It's there. I believe Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 and 27, Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, holds the answer. See, I believe that's where the answer is. So, in spite of man's strain, God never once seemingly wanted to give up on him. What is it? See, I got too much of me in that man. I hope God will help us to get heartbroken and sad over the many souls who are ignorant of God. Oh, Jesus. Many a person is flat out ignorant of God. Let us not ever, forever settle for the idea just us four and no more. Us few, let the rest go on to the lake. Let's do all we can. So we are. Leaving Psalm 50 and 15, before I leave it, let me read you one more time. And call upon me in the day of trouble. Yeah. I will deliver. It doesn't sound like he might. Huh? I will. Yeah. We practice communicating with the Lord in the time of peace so that when war and disturbance break out, we will be in the habit or the practice of talking and calling upon him. Alright? Now let me throw another one in your lap. Psalm 91. Oh, this is a home run with the bases loaded. This is the ninth inning. This last man will be the winner. Psalm 91, 14 and 15. Because he has set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. Oh my God. I will set him on high. Yeah. Brother, what did he mean, set him on high? When I do the delivering, I put him in a position so everything that mess with him can see that I brought him out and raised him up above everything you tried to do to him. Even those who don't like him have to admit, look what God did. I will set him on high because he has known my name. He shall call upon me. I will answer. Not I might, I will answer. I will answer. Verse number 15, I will be with him in trouble. Now it'd be good if he just catch us after trouble. He said, I'll be with him in trouble. One of the most colorful examples of him in with them in trouble is found in the book of Daniel. They put three young men in a fiery furnace. They went back to inspect the furnace and found there was
four.
He said, "Is he with them? Y'all put three in there?" And listen, don't get funny, but sometimes you ought to tell your opposition. And when you make a situation for me, make it big enough for two, because I'm going to have two. See, I've never known God to break an appointment. A few things. I live long enough to know that sometimes you got to say, "Lord, I don't see it, I don't feel it. But since you are here, do something to make me know that you're here. Whatever it takes, do something." Sometimes God just moves his hand. You know, he got a big hand. See, the breeze out of his hand brings a refreshing upon your soul, and you find yourself feeling like running and nobody's after you. You want to holler, nothing is hurting you. So you know I'm in the presence of the Lord. For in his presence is fullness of joy, and his right hand there presence evermore. Lord, I thank you that I felt the breeze when it passed over. Surely thou art with me. Furnace could easily testify. Now, we're not here trying to prove a point, but they have crossed the line. They want us to hear the music and bow to a God that's not a God. Our God is one. We don't have to carry him. He carries us. They got a God they have to carry.
Well.
We're not going to bow. And I love the way they answer the king. Say, "King," they was really respectful. You know, in so many words, we're not trying to take your position. You got a right to do what you please. But we just want you to know this. We ain't going to bow. The one thing about God, if we don't bow, he'll make sure we don't murder.
All right. All right.
Hallelujah.
You know, years ago you sang a song, standing on the promises. God my Savior, I am standing on the promises of God. Hallelujah. And may I say this? When you're standing, the less you say, the better off you are, because you can open your own mouth and bleed out stuff that challenges you. So shut up. Say, "Lord, I'm holding my peace because I want you to fight the battle." When it's all said and done, even those who don't know you will know it had to be you to do what you just did. So I'm going to shut up. But I tell you one thing, Lord, once you deliver me, I'm open my mouth. Hallelujah! That's one of the reasons all of us ought to want to go to heaven, so we can give him the kind of praise he rightfully deserves. I want to be there when they crown him King of Kings. I want to be there when they crown him Lord of Lords. I want to be there when the 420 elders bow before him and everybody lash out, "Holy is the Lord, holy." I want to be there. Some things you might feel good about hearing about. So so-and-so, this ain't half, boy, it was so good, you feel good about it. But that, when they crown him king, I'm going to be there. So they said, "Oh, I'm going to see that." heavenly host bowed before him and shouted, "Holy." I want to mingle my voice. Holy. Worthy. We're still on track. I think I got about 14 more minutes. Better make good of them. Holy! Now, let me finish this one on him expecting the call. All right. Now you got 34:15. The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, ears open to the crowd. You got Psalm 50:15. Call upon me in the day of trouble, I will deliver you. You got Psalm 91:14. Because he set his love upon me, therefore will I honor him. And on 15, I'll be with him in trouble, so forth and so on. Now, we got another verse. Woo! No, somebody said, that's enough for me. Now, let's just get more and more of a hard time. Psalm 34, we're going back to 34. And verse 6. This poor man and the Lord. Since we've already said God is no respecter of a person, if he heard this poor man, what about this one? Hey! Any of you in here that's praying about a matter that seems like it's not getting any better, be thankful that it hasn't gotten any worse. And be reminded that it's not too late. See, the enemy want to slow walk you and get you so discouraged, so down and out, so busted and so disgusted, so bewildered and so confused that you say, well, Lord, I'm dying to be saved. And Lord, pay me no mind. He don't, Lord, I can't. He love crybabies. If there's anybody here that hates the devil, the best thing you can do is stay happy. He hates happy folk. You know why he hates happy folk? Because a happy person reflects what he once knew. And to see you happy reminds him of what he lost. Hey! He wants you to look pitiful, sound pitiful. He wants you to look down and hang around with clowns that's down. You can't help them and they can't help you. Now, he loved that kind of situation. But boy, when you walk in the room and change the atmosphere because of the motivation and inspiration upon your life, you make it mad. Anybody don't mind being mad, be happy enough to let some of what's in